Thank you. Good morning. Very excited to be here this morning and talk to you a little bit about AI and about feelings. But before I do that, I want to give you a quick update, because 2 years ago, on this very stage, I showed the audience at the time these four paintings. And I said that one of them was actually not painted by the great Dutch master, by Rembrandt, but was completely imagined by AI. And I gave the audience one hint. I said, this one is like a 17th century selfie, like, you know, a self-portrait clearly made by the master, so that left only three choices. And then eventually, I revealed that it is this one, the third gentleman from the left, who never actually existed, who never posed for Rembrandt, and was completely created by AI. So that's a neat feat, but it's all so 2017. How about these people? Are they real? Well, at least two of them are not real, completely made up by AI. The hair, the skin, the eyes, the wrinkles, everything. And I'll give you one hint. This lady, maybe her eye color is a little bit different, left from right. So perhaps the AI made a small mistake. On the other hand, David Bowie had two different color eyes, so maybe it's natural. I'll leave that to you and we'll revisit that later. But can we agree at this point already that AI can paint any face on any person? And would that be harder to do if those faces moved, like in a video? Now, this gentleman actually existed, almost certainly. And I'm using him to tee up what we call a deep fake. And that's a fake video created by AI using a deep learning algorithm. Have a look.
Imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you try.
Imagine that, the world leaders at your bidding. But seriously, think about the potential, how creepy this really is. So what have we learned so far? So AI can clearly fake images. It can fake video. So essentially, you could have a completely fake person read some script, and it would be completely fake news. But we would probably think that the fake news, especially if it's sort of creative, would still have to be written by a human. Well, maybe not. Imagine this. This is a prompt. So this is a prompt given to an AI system, and it's the AI's task to, from that prompt, write the story. No background, no details, no context, just make it up. So let's see how it does. I'll just let you read this. Signed, artificial intelligence. This is actually creepier than the deepfake video, I think. And the actual story was even longer, but equally credible. Now, I don't claim by any stretch of imagination to be an expert in nuclear disaster management, but I am totally buying this. So at this point, are you at all concerned about all these AI algorithms? Well, if you are, it will probably get worse. Because we're thinking about AI as algorithms that learn, and that's not incorrect. But what if, at the same time, they could also evolve? If there was sort of a survival of the fittest going on with algorithms. And I'm going to show you a short video about what is called artificial life. And imagine a world populated by thousands of algorithms trying to survive by optimizing a specific outcome. And if one algorithm meets another algorithm and they fall in love and they have children, literally, that is how it works, those children will inherit survival traits from the parents. So if you did that for a few billion years, and that's probably in a few minutes or a few hours on a fast computer, you get some very creative algorithms. So in this case, what I'm going to show you are algorithms that, in order to survive, have to learn to move. So that's what survival means. And the first creature, or artificial animal, I'll let you judge, that you will see, sort of has discovered what insects on Earth also use to walk. But the second one is a little bit more creative. Here goes. That's fascinating and creepy at the same time, isn't it? It's survival of the fittest, of algorithms evolving and adapting. And we really have to remember that algorithms can now be like that. They are no longer those simple linear creatures. And one sure hopes that when AI matures and when it evolves, that it will also develop, you know, a decent set of moral and ethical values. So let's talk about that. And I know morality is not something you run into all the time when you're here in Vegas. and that's why I'm told, you know, a lot of things have to stay here all the time. But let me ask you a simple question. Who would you rather kill? Yes, I did say that, nothing scary. It's a simple choice. These are moral choices. So what would you do? You're driving a car. Would you drive straight through and kill the cats that, by the way, are jaywalking? I mean, they're cats. Or would you swerve to the left, maybe at some risk to yourself, and kill the five dogs that are meekly following traffic rules, I might add? What would you do? So this may be unfairly pitting cat lovers versus dog lovers. So let's make this a little harder. Moral choice number two. So now, this is a self-driving car. Should the AI in the self-driving car sacrifice its passengers, and arguably itself, or should it drive over those five pedestrians who are, like cats, running the light? What would you do? And then one last one. Choice, same thing, AI driving a car. Should it sacrifice its passengers or run over those two doctors who are on their way to saving a lot of lives and countless other lives in the course of their careers? So these are hard choices. And human philosophy is not completely clear-cut on what the next best action is under all circumstances. In fact, this is only trivial if you're a sociopath. So, can I just ask, this has nothing to do with the keynote, just out of personal curiosity, did anyone think these were trivial choices? And can you raise your hand so we know where you are? Yeah? Yeah. Anyway, ideally, we would like to get to a point where AI would think, gee, I couldn't live with myself if I killed those cats or the dogs. It's not completely clear yet, I think, when AI evolves, whether it will evolve to be a dog person or a cat person. That's too soon to tell. But that kind of self-reflection, if it ever comes, would be something like true artificial morality. And I would coin the term amorality, but I think that's maybe already taken. But we did ask a bunch of people, 5,000 people to be exact, about their opinions about A-morality. We repeated a survey that we did 2 years ago on AI across people in the US, Japan, and Europe. And here's what they think. So, 3 out of 5 humans think that AI can't possibly behave morally. Now, as before, we didn't ask the machines, so this is a bit of a biased view, possibly, but that's a lot of people. And as an aside, 2 out of 3 believe that companies have an obligation to do what's morally right beyond what's legally required. So it follows that companies who are using AI to engage with their customers, which is all companies, have their work cut out for them. And we'll talk a little bit in a moment about what that work looks like. Meanwhile, here's another interesting stat. 1 out of 4 humans think AI will take over the world. We repeated this question from 2 years ago. It's 27%, up a little bit, but not much from where it was 2 years ago. But interestingly, the French, as a group, as a population, are particularly concerned about this. It's 40% of the French that think we have to bend the knee to our robot overlords in the not-so-distant future. I don't know what that means, but I just thought I'd share it. And then to end this on the stats on a sweet note, if you think such a thing is sweet, 1 out of 3 humans would like to have a machine say it loves them. That's interesting. And again, 40% of the French, But 40% of Generation Z actually thinks this is the case. Now, I'm not a psychologist, but I think there's something there. But on a serious note, the respondents were very unified in saying that morality and ethics is a critical thing for AI. But not every AI will be driving a car and having to make life or death decisions. So are we off the hook when AI is not driving a car, but customer engagement instead? Not really. We really cannot leave ethical customer engagement to AI quite yet. Not fully, not unattended. And here is one reason why. More images. These people actually exist. I mean, some are actors, but yes. And this is not about the images. This is about words. So like 6 years ago or so, Google mined Google News is sort of in support of their AI translation efforts, because they were interested in words in context. And by mining Google News and the gazillions of news articles, they hoped the AI would learn something about the world. And if you assume that Google News is a fair representation of news on the internet, and if you assume that news is a fair representation of what's happening in the world, and I know there's a lot of debate on this continent, but I'll let that go, but if you assume that, then the AI can learn a lot of things about the world and about us, about humans. So for instance, it can infer, just from the news, no coding, it can infer that sisters is to woman as brothers is to men. Perfect. No coding, inferred from news. Here is where it gets a little bit more worrisome. If you ask it, father is to doctor as mother is to what? What do you think it says? What do you hope it says? It says nurse. Ouch. And here's another gem. It also would say that if man is to computer programmer, as woman is to, the only possible answer could be homemaker. Double ouch. How is this for girls in tech? And it's not the algorithm or the AI that is wrong. The data is biased. And any AI that is studying real-world data will be biased because it's learning from us. And we're not always setting great examples. So with all that potential for deceit and bias, you may recall that 2 years ago, Pega introduced the T-switch to control algorithms that were directly or indirectly engaging with customers. And the T in T-switch stands for transparency, but also for trust. Because your company has millions, millions of customers. And you will have many, many algorithms that are impacting those customers in meaningful ways. Algorithms that decide what to offer them, who to reward, predict who will be in arrears or is going to churn. Algorithms that are trying to figure out a customer's mood or determine the next best action. And these algorithms can be transparent or they can be opaque. And transparent algorithms can explain themselves. So you can inspect them and you can see what patterns they have inferred from the data and how they're trying to solve a particular problem. Opaque algorithms have a hard time explaining themselves. Much like humans have a hard time explaining their gut feel and their hunches and their intuition. Pretty much the same thing. But you can't just ditch opaque algorithms because they're more powerful. They're not constrained by having to explain themselves, so they can be more powerful. And more powerful algorithms, more accurate algorithms, are not just good for companies, they can also actually be good for customers. Better decisions can be better. So you can't really ditch opaque algorithms. So you need both. And whatever or whoever is creating them, if it's AI that is generating an algorithm, or it's the data scientist, regardless of that, the algorithms and their predictions need to be trusted. They need to be fair, so no bias. They need to be explainable, and not just because you want to understand the algorithms. It may also be a legal requirement, like CDPR in GDPR in Europe or CCPA in California. And the algorithms need to be robust. If an algorithm is sort of live, dealing with customers, it may get corrupted, like Tay did. Do you remember Tay? Tay was, or probably is, I don't know how that works with software exactly, but she was the Microsoft chatbot, and talking and tweeting to real people, she got corrupted almost immediately and became a blatant racist. So you don't want to do that. So that's what robustness is. It was really bad. You should look that up. And lastly, the lineage of an algorithm. Who or what created the algorithm? What data was used? Who approved it? How was it tested? Those kind of things. That's how you get trusted algorithms. And that's where the T-switch comes in. So your company can make sure that it insists on transparent algorithms where that is required, but allow opaque algorithms where that is feasible. So yes, we have to be careful with AI. You want to make sure that rogue algorithms are not mistreating your customers or making you liable. But before we panic, let me show you this. You may ask, what is this? I thought it was obvious, it's a bear attack. It's on this big screen, it's a little blurry. That's because it happened so fast. And the bear is fake, actually, but that's not the point of this slide. What I wanted to do is to show you a chart to help determine the risk of a bear attack. Because if you were to ask a modern-day AI how to avoid a bear attack, it might well suggest that you move to Mercury. or Neptune. Both these planets have acceptable risks of bear attack. Whereas in contrast, on Earth, the risk of a bear attack is extremely high. So you're chuckling about this, but I don't think an AI would find this amusing. I mean, nothing about this is incorrect. And I think that until an AI matures to the point where it really feels like this is funny, I don't think we have to be that concerned, at least not as much as the French are. So let's return to transparent AI one more time. So as I said, it's often helpful and sometimes mandatory that AI can explain itself. But that's not particularly awesome if you don't like the explanation. So if AI comes up with a decision or a recommendation, and it may be profitable, but it's inappropriate, or it's irrelevant, or even illegal, what we need to insert here is some kind of an ethical framework, so that your AI can treat your customers like you would like to be treated yourself. People will never forget how you made them feel. And what Ms. Angelou is saying here about people, I think, is equally true about companies. And that's a problem, because in that same survey, it turns out that only 2 out of 5 humans believe that machine empathy can be relevant for listening and care. That's not a lot of people. And the rest of them pretty much thinks that AI will be like a sociopath. So possibly charming, but definitely very manipulative. So that's a lot of people. But the problem is, the same number of people don't think that humans are the gold standard in empathy either. So now what? Well, what it means is that organizations that want to listen and care at scale have to make sure that humans and AI work together. And sure, you can have an AI system whisper some recommendation in the ear of an agent and then hope the agent will add the human touch, but in our digital age, that option is not always available and it wouldn't scale. So what if we could add empathetic considerations to insights for machine learning? I mean, I'm not talking about AI that we would expect to cry when it's watching the end of the movie Titanic. That's not what we're trying to do. What we're trying to do is to create a more considerate, a warmer, a more caring version of customer engagement. And it would be really nice if we had a corporate brain, like the Customer Decision Hub, that is figuring out next best action, but that would take empathetic factors into account. Things like seeking relevance, that Nicole was talking about yesterday. Seeking relevance is empathetic. You don't want to waste the time of the people, of the person you're talking to. Insisting on suitability is empathetic. Sure, you can sell that mortgage to that customer, but did you check whether that mortgage would actually get that person into trouble and would make him lose his house? Or sure, you can sell that rate plan with that telephone, but did you make sure that she's really going to use all those gigabytes, or are you just setting her up for buyer remorse later? And maximizing profit at every opportunity at any cost is almost certainly unempathetic. So is spamming people that are not interested in what you have to say. It's actually, if you think about it, it's very hard. If this was human-to-human conversation, it would be very hard to, you know, keep a conversation going, or a relationship for that matter, if you ignore what's said, if you insist on bringing up irrelevant topics, and if you only care about what is important to you. So an empathetic corporate brain would try really, really hard to stay in the relationship. And it does that by sensing the customer's context. Make it outside in, not inside out. Making sure that the brain knows what Sarah was just doing. What was she doing in that channel? If she now called into the contact center, what was she trying to do before, knowing the context? What is her mood? If she's upset, is that really the time to sell something to her? And sometimes there are factors outside of the company that may have impacted Sarah. Right? What if she lived very close to a raging wildfire? Is that really the time to, you know, nag her about her outstanding mortgage payment? Show some empathy. And then when we have that sense of her context, we need to interpret her interests and intent. What is relevant to her? What is suitable for her? What is the value to her outside in? And of course, because this is not a charity, we do need to balance that with the business interests. It's always that balance between customer objectives and customer objectives. So the company needs to make sure that they understand what is the risk to us? What is the value to us? Are we compliant? So let's make all of this a little bit more practical and actionable. Let me show you how you can productize empathy. This is the Customer Empathy Advisor. It's part of the Customer Decision Hub and specifically part of the MBA Designer that Kareem touched on yesterday. It's not part of the current release. We will be releasing this near the end of the year. But what it does, it will allow companies to control and experiment with the level of empathy in their customer engagement strategy. Let's have a quick look what we're looking at here. So this is a slider. So this hypothetical bank, let's call it Ubank, is experimenting, or maybe they just want to know the impact of if they didn't insert a lot of empathy in here. On this scale, obviously, on the left, we have it's very warm. It's, you know, there's a lot of empathy. It's the color of the heart. On the right, it's very cold. It's the color of ice. And that's not a judgment. It's actually a choice. It's a choice for this bank to decide on what kind of bank, what kind of brand they want to be. So in this cold setting, they can, for instance, look at all the offers and actions and treatments and customer engagement messages that are in play across all of the different channels. And they can see how often that is happening, and that's the size, the length of the bar. And the color indicates how much empathy was used. So let's look at this one, because this mortgage offer looks particularly chilly. So let me add that it's not about the product or the message. It's fine to sell a mortgage, to sell a high-value product. This is about the circumstances in which it was offered to the customer. The fact that it is this cold means that almost certainly, overall, customers were not interested in this. Or we didn't check, or Ubank didn't check, if the customers they tried to sell it to were suitable for this particular mortgage. So that's what we see in this chart. And then if we move to the right, we're looking at sort of the opposite. Here we are looking at those messages, those customer engagement interactions that are the coldest, that are the most heartless. And we're looking at how often that happens. And then we can look at things that are offered what I would call against relevance. And again, relevance is very important. In human conversations, if you're not relevant, you're basically trying to sell something to someone who is not particularly interested. And this particular bank in this setting does that 82% of the time. Now, that's not the end of the world. I mean, companies are allowed to make a profit, and they can't always talk about products that people are interested in. But how often you do that, that's a choice. And 82% is a lot. And as a consequence, this bank, every day, is wasting 18.2 million interactions where they talked about something, and they could have been talking about something that would be more relevant to the customer. So that brings us to the opportunity cost. So you can do a cost-benefit analysis on this particular graph and on the line, and you can see that this is the annual value that this brain is generating for this bank. And on the left-hand side, sort of in the Arctic area of this chart, they are really pushing products that are not very relevant. And on the right-hand side, they're probably overdoing it on the touchy-feely, making customers happy, but at the expense of profitability. So again, that's a choice. So maybe Ubank wants to see what happens under another setting. So this is the cold setting. If they change it to something warmer, all the charts immediately update. Let me do that again. So maybe that was a little fast. This is the empathy level that we saw before, relatively cold. And this is when we insert some heart. And you can see that warmer propositions and warmer messages are getting more frequently presented in all of the channels, on the web, in the contact center, everywhere. And also, to the right, if you look at the biggest empathy offenders, they're still there, but not nearly as frequently presented as before. And as a consequence, the wasted moments, the missed opportunities, have dropped below 10 million. So this is the customer empathy advisor. Go see it in the pavilion if you have a chance. It's live, and we will be releasing that, as I said, near the end of the year. So yesterday, Alan talked about the brain, which is adding intelligence to customer engagement. And he spoke about the muscle, DPA, that is making customer engagement more efficient. And then he talked to us about the heart, about, in this case, empathy for your customers. And using real-time AI and using the customer empathy advisor, we can now operationalize empathy at scale. So when you talk to your customers online, through their mobile devices, through the call center, an outbound email, a chatbot, any channel, now, for the first time, you can consider how it makes them feel. One thing before I go, I promise you to tell you which of these people never lived, never existed, and which ones were completely faked by AI. And the answer is all of them. Thank you very much.